Okay, so first of all, let me thank Roger and all the program committee for organizing such a really nice event and really stimulating conference. So what I'm going to present is a joint work with William Brock from University of Wisconsin and Carl Holmes from University of Amsterdam. I'm based at Catholic University in Milan, but I still have a research fellow at the University of Amsterdam, where I did 2 years for my postdoc. So what I'm going to present today is an attempt to model animal spirits in a simple dynamic general equilibrium model, and introducing the role of heterogeneous expectations in the amplification and duration of crisis. It's the first time that I'm presenting the paper, so any comments or suggestions are more than welcome. So our, as I just said, the main motivation of the paper are animal spirits, because we think that they played and they play an important role in economic crisis. And starting from Keynes, most of macroeconomic activity is governed by animal spirits. Why? Because people have non-economic motives, and due to this feature of people, they are not always rational in pursuit of economic interests. So these two main features give us the idea of animal spirits as Keynes was describing it as the main source of economic fluctuations. Moreover, a few years ago, Akerlof and Schiller wrote a really nice book in which they discuss essentially the 5 types of animal spirits, being confidence, fairness, corruption, money illusion, and stories. They say, and we agree with them, that the cornerstone of animal spirits is confidence. But it's also well known that animal spirits are really difficult to conceptualize, model, and measure. So the goal of this paper, as I already anticipated, is to build a simple dynamic equilibrium model of agents' confidence. And our main result is that a sudden collapse of confidence will accelerate and amplify the downturn or a crisis, and moreover, it will slow down the recovery after the crisis. So we will have an interaction between confidence and heterogeneous expectations that will give us this main result. So the main hypothesis, so the key novelty of the paper is to model on one side confidence and on the other side to introduce a specific role for heterogeneous expectations. And in order to do so, we follow the Brock and Holmes approach by 1997. And in particular, the main tool for modeling confidence in a market for loans will be lenders' heterogeneous expectations about an exogenous probability of success of borrowers. So essentially, lenders will form expectations about the probability of success of the borrowers. And these expectations will be our measure of confidence in the model. The main findings of the paper are mainly two. So in the presence of even a small fraction of pessimistic beliefs, an unexpected negative shock to the credit market will make this pessimistic belief self-fulfilling, and consequently, it will amplify a crisis and it will slow down the recovery. Moreover, a small fraction of pessimistic agents in the economy will have large aggregate effects, as we will see in a while. So the model is a really simple model. Essentially, we have a market for loans. We model the household sector with an overlapping generation structure. Our households will save and consume. And savings from households can be invested into a risk-free asset or in a risky asset. And the risky asset, in particular in our model, is productive investment. So essentially, we don't have banks in the model, but households can lend to firms. From the firm's side of the model, we have that firms borrow capital for productive investment and they pay wages to households. So in order to produce, they need to ask for a loan to the households and they will pay wages to households. Through the market clearing for the credit market, we will determine what we define as the contract rate for loans in our economy. So the model a bit more in details. As I said, we have a two periods overlapping generations framework for the household sector, and in particular, the household maximizes the utility function as defined in the relation over here. So essentially, they maximize utility over consumption when young and consumption when old. Under the budget constraints, that defines consumption when young as the difference between wages minus savings, and consumption when old as an endowment when old plus the return on investment. So in particular, CTT and CTT plus one are consumption respectively when young and when old. WT is equal to wages from the production sector plus an endowment when young. ST are real savings. Delta T is the fraction of saving that goes in the risky asset. And rho is the risk-free interest rate. And finally, lambda expected T plus one is the expected average productivity of capital. So the expected average productivity of the risky asset. Solving the maximization problem for the household, we obtain the optimal savings as defined in this relation over here. And in particular, in this relation, mu e t plus one is the expected average return on investment. As you see, it depends on the return on the risk-free and on the risky asset. For the sake of simplicity, because we want to keep the model as simple as possible in order to be able to to capture the main findings. So we assume that endowment when old is equal to zero, so such that savings will boil down to this simple relation over here. So essentially, total savings ST are equal to WT over two. So in words, what we are doing, we are assuming that savings are perfectly inelastic with respect to known and unknown returns on asset next period. From the firm side, so firms demand for loans and they borrow to finance productive investment and they choose capital XT maximizing their profits. Where, in particular, PT represents the probability of success and is known by the firm, and RT, greater than one, is the gross contract rate. So at the end, optimal demand for loans is given by this relation over here. So essentially, it's a decreasing relation in the contract rate and an increasing relation in the probability of success. And wages are just determined as residually from this relation over here. In the paper, I don't have it in the slides, but in the paper we specialize this production function as a Cobb-Douglas x to the power of alpha, with alpha smaller than one. So first of all, I will present you the equilibrium under homogeneous expectations, and then I will switch to the heterogeneous expectation scenario. So in the paper, it is shown how to get the expected loan return, and essentially the expected loan return is a function of the expectation on the probability of success, PET plus one, and the contract rate, RT. Where, as I already said, PET plus one is the expected probability of success and is our measure of confidence in the economy that we are modeling. So the expectation on the probability of success of the borrower is a proxy for confidence in our setup, and it will play a crucial role when we will analyze the role of a crisis in this simple model. We assume that there is risk neutrality and imposing the no-arbitrage condition such that the return on the risky asset is equal to the return on the risk-free asset, the no-arbitrage level for the contract rate will be a nonlinear function of the expectations on the probability of success. So R star represents the no-arbitrage level of the contract rate and is decreasing in the probability of success. In the expectations about the probability of success. We obtain also what we define the loan supply correspondence, that is a function of the contract rate and the expectation on the probability of success. E bar is an indicator function. So essentially here what we get is that when the interest rate, this is more clear from this graph. So essentially, this is our temporary equilibrium. So the red line represents the supply correspondence, and as you see, is a step function. It's a time-varying step function because it depends on the expectations on the probability of success and on the contract rate. So essentially, our temporary equilibrium, depending on the demand, can be either on point A or on point B. If we are on point A, the contract rate is exactly the non-arbitrage level for the contract rate. Otherwise, it will be determined just using the inverse of the demand function. So we can have either an equilibrium in point A or in point B, depending on how high is the demand function. And as you see, the expectations about the probability of success, that is our measure of confidence, play a crucial role. In fact, given the level of the interest rate on the risk-free asset rho, the higher is the expectation about the probability of success, the lower will be the level of the contract rate R star, and the higher will be the demand for capital. So we assume an exogenous stochastic probability process of the R1 type for the probability of success as the one defined in the relation 1. So essentially, our probability of success is exogenous in the model, and it evolves according to an R1 process. And we will analyze the homogeneous case expectations in these different scenarios. So we will consider an economy in which everyone is the same and everyone has naive expectations. Rational, so naive expectations, essentially, they are just keeping the last observation. Rational expectations are using the right law of motion for the probability process. The average expectations are just taking the average given the time series that they are observing. Trend following expectations, and finally we introduce what we define pessimistic or minimum expectations. So these are our pessimistic agents in the economy. What they do, they look at the time series of the realization of the probability of success in the last 10 periods and they take the minimum. So they are really pessimistic and they think, they look at the time series of the realization of the probability of success and they take the minimum of the last 10 period. So this graph on the upper panel in green, you have the realization for the probability, for the exogenous probability of success. In red, the forecast in the case of naive expectations, and in the lower panel, you have the realization for the contract rate. Something that I forgot to say, that we are, all in all the simulations that I'm going to show, we are always using the same realization for the AR1 process for the probability of success. So in the case of naive expectations, essentially they lag realized probability by one period, and what we define a crisis, the crisis period, is the period in which the realization of our confidence measure, it has the probability of success, its lowest value. So essentially, in period 31, what the probability of success reaches its lowest value, and this is what we define a crisis in this economy. And we will analyze what will happen after this period. So in the case of naive expectations, as I said, they lag realized probability by one period, and we observe regarding the contract rate, a spike in the contract rate immediately after the crisis in period 32. So you can see it here. So the contract rate hits its maximum one period after the crisis. Essentially, what we observe is that the dynamics of the contract rate are mean reversion to its long-run equilibrium value, that is just rho over mu, where mu is the long-run average for the probability of success. These are the dynamics under homogeneous rational expectations, and what we observe is that rational expectations track closely the realized probability. We have the crisis in period 31, and we observe the spike in the contract rate exactly in the same period when the crisis occurs, so in period 31. And the difference with the naive expectations is that the peaks are less extreme. So rational expectations are correctly predicting mean reversion on average after an extreme observation of the evolution of the probability of success. These are the dynamics under homogeneous average expectations, and what we, as expected, we observe is that average expectations smooth out aggregate behavior. So we don't have extremes, and the contract rate just slowly increases after the crisis, and then it slowly converges to its long-run equilibrium level. Here we observe dynamics under homogeneous trend follower expectations, and what you see is that the trend follower expectations undershoot or overshoot the minimum or the maximum value of the realized probability of success. So essentially, they miss every turning point. Because of this, we observe more extreme maximum values of the contract rate in periods 32 and 33. Immediately after the crisis. So essentially, what are trend-following believers doing is they are amplifying the magnitude of the crisis. How do we observe the magnitude of the crisis? Looking at the levels of the contract rate. Finally, dynamics under homogeneous pessimistic expectations with the 10 legs, what we get is that after each local minimum, of the probability of success, so after, for example, the crisis period in 31, the contract rate spikes at a local maximum, it stays there for at least 10 periods, or jumps to a new local maximum. So what we observe from these dynamics is that crises are deep and much more persistent, so the contract rate hits higher level and it stays there for a longer period. And pessimistic beliefs essentially are slowing down the recovery after the crisis. So once the contract rate hits its maximum after the crisis, it stays there for a while. So the crisis it stays longer. So now I will go through the heterogeneous expectation case. As I already said, we are following the Brockendom's 1997 approach. So we will have J types of lenders with expectations on return of the risky assets, such that the expected loan return will depend now on the expectation of the J lender on the probability of success. We have a performance measure that is a relative past squared errors, and as defined in this relation over here. And as you can see, the contract rate enters as a weight for the squared errors. Gamma is a memory parameter, and small ujt represents the relative performance measure. Moreover, the fractions of our different types of agents in the economy will evolve according to a discrete choice model with asynchronous updating. Essentially, this is the framework that Florian was showing the first day. And in particular, in the case of asynchronous updating, delta reflects the inertia in the choice of the heuristics. So the inertia that agents have in switching from one rule to another. So we in defining the market equilibrium under heterogeneous expectations, what we have is that we will have heterogeneous expectations on the probability of success, and the long supply correspondence now will depend also on the evolution of the fractions over time. And as I said, Pj et plus 1 represents expectations of type j on the probability of success, and njt is the fraction of agents of type j at time t. Imposing the market clearing condition for market for loans, we determine the contract rate. And essentially, in a heterogeneous world with two types of agent, what you get is a two-step supply correspondence that is a two-step function. So things are getting more complicated. Here, so if you have two types, type one and type two, here we are representing the case in which the probability of success of type one, that type one is forecasting, is higher with respect to the probability of success that type two is forecasting, such that the contract rate in point C is higher than in point A. So temporary equilibrium A, B, C, or D, once more, will depend. So essentially, the economy will be in one of these equilibrium depending on the demand curve. In the paper, we have different examples with the two types. And finally, we have a section in which we are running an experiment with an example with six types. So we will have in our economy six types that are interacting all together at the same time. So essentially, we will have all the five types that I already presented in the homogeneous case. And moreover, we add what we call the worst case expectation. The worst case expectation is an agent that is even more pessimistic than the minimum. So essentially what he does is to look at the time C, the realization of the probability of success, the last 10 periods, and the prediction of the other forecasters in the previous period, and he takes the minimum. So he takes the minimum between the 10 realization and the other five expectations in the previous period. So in this graph, you see, sorry, how much time do I have? Three minutes. So in this graph, we are separating, the six types, because otherwise it's a mess. It's already a mess like this. So essentially, you have to think of this graph as a unique graph. And here you see, so in green, the realization for the probability of success, and in different colors, all the six types. So for example, Chan is the trend follower, the purple are the average, the black are the naive, the yellow are the worst case. For example, here when we hit the crisis period, they are predicting an even lower level for the probability of success with respect to the minimum, that are the blue line. Here you see the evolving over time of the fractions of different types. And as you can see, around period 30, 31, when the crisis occurs, the yellow and the blue one are around, summing up the minimum and the worst case scenario, have around that they are representing around the 40% of our economy. So 40% of people during the crisis period are using the two more pessimistic rules. These are the, on the upper panel, you see the contract rate in the six types scenario, and in the lower panel, the output. So as you can see, after immediately, when the crisis occurs, you have a spike in the contract rate that is even higher than in the case in which we had homogeneous minimum beliefs. and it stays there for a while. So essentially here we are observing the interaction between minimum believers, worst believers, worst case believers, and trend follower believers. Trend follower believers are amplifying in terms of in magnitude terms the effect of the crisis. So the contract rate goes even higher. And then the two pessimistic believers are amplifying the crisis in terms of duration of the crisis. And you observe in the lower panel the effects on the output. So in the contract rate, we have more persistence in terms of the crisis, of the effects of the crisis. We don't observe the same persistence in the output, but this is due to the positive effect of the realization of the probability of success. It is an air one, so it hits the minimum, but then the probability of success starts recovering, and it has a positive effect on the output. So here we are comparing the heterogeneous expectations with six types benchmark with the rational expectations homogeneous benchmark. So in red you have the six types and in black the rational expectations. So what you observe in the upper panel is that the contract rate in the case of the six types heterogeneous expectations is always higher than in the case of the rational expectations homogeneous benchmark. So the crisis is amplified in terms of magnitude, but it also in terms of duration. Because while in here with the rational expectations, you hit the maximum, but then since the probability of success is recovering, also the contract rate is decreasing, you don't observe the same result in the case of the six types. In the lower panel, we have the benchmark, the same kind of plot for the output. And what we observe is that the output in the case of the six types is always lower than in the case of the rational expectations benchmark. This is my last. Here, what we observe, I think this is the key plot of the paper. So essentially, we are plotting the heterogeneous expectation, what we define the heterogeneous expectations risk premium, that is just the difference between the contract rate in the case of heterogeneous expectations and in the case of rational expectations. And in the lower panel, you have the relative difference in terms of output. So the lower panel measures the output loss due to heterogeneity that reaches its peak around 3%. So in terms of because of the heterogeneity, we have a loss in the output that is about of the trend equal to 3% with respect to the rational expectations benchmark. And in terms of the contract rate, we have a risk premium that is that makes the contract rate higher in the case of heterogeneous expectations with respect to the rational expectations of about 6 percentage points. So to conclude, what we do, we model confidence with lenders' heterogeneous expectations about the probability of success of borrowers, and we find that a small fraction of pessimistic agents in the economy amplifies the magnitude of a crisis, and moreover, they slow down the recovery. Moreover, other types of human behavior, such as trend followers or worst case, make these effects even stronger. And our conclusion is that maybe policymakers should take bounded rational heterogeneous expectations into account when they have to manage what is a complex economy. I'm done.